chapter.
Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County, New Jersey chapter of NOW. And my name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and the entire production crew are all members of this chapter of NOW. We've been at this a long time, currently in our 18th or 19th year, depending upon who you're talking to. All of our shows are archived at the Sophia Smith Collection, and they're also all available on YouTube at www.youtube.com/MCNOW, Morris County Now, NJ. Our title for today's show is Teaching Sexuality Education, Sex Education. And we are fortunate to have as our guest one of the outstanding experts in the field. Bill Taverner is the Executive Director of the Center for Family Life Education, the National Education Division of Planned Parenthood of Central and Greater Northern New Jersey. He is the Editor-in-Chief of the American Journal of Sexuality Education and the lead editor, and this is exciting because this book has just come out. He's the lead editor of the forthcoming 2-volume, 3rd edition of Teaching Safer Sex. And that's available at www.sexedstore.com. You see it now up on the screen. And welcome, Bill.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm glad you could come because we have lots and lots and lots of questions. But I'd like to start by asking you a little bit about yourself before we begin.
Sure. Well, I've been doing sex ed for about 20 years. It's really my passion. I like to...
Sex or ed?
No, I've been doing a little bit of both, but I'll be sharing more of the sex ed part of it this evening. I'm interested in sex ed throughout the lifespan, particularly young people and their access to sexuality education. I think my interest was generated by the lack of education that I had when I was in high school myself. So I'm excited to speak with you about it today.
Well, I'm really glad because most of us beyond a certain age really haven't had any. And those who are younger may have had something, but it may not be what it is that you consider to be good sex education.
Yeah.
It is going on, but...
It is, and there are some people who are doing sex ed very, very well, and there's pockets of excellent sex ed happening in New Jersey and around the country. And there's a lot of poor sex ed that's being done, and non-sex ed. You know, we've had, since the early 1980s, we've had federal funding for abstinence-only until marriage programs, a lot more funding beginning in the mid-90s until today. For the first time, we're seeing federal funding for teen pregnancy prevention programs, and that's wonderful, but I think we've our society has really been influenced by a culture that has taught just say no, and really not much more than that.
Mm-hmm. And is afraid that if we talk about it, somehow it'll generate more interest in it and kids will start experimenting just because they've been exposed to the discussion.
Yeah, I think that's the belief. I mean, that's not the reality. Mm-hmm. But that is a concern that some adults do have. The research doesn't support it. Kids are, and if you think about it, it makes sense. Kids are interested in the sex regardless of what adults have to say about it. They don't need our prodding to become interested in sex. And when we teach sex ed, we're not teaching about it in a salacious way. We're mm-hmm. teaching the facts. We're teaching information that is life-saving and useful and things that people need and deserve to know.
Yeah, I agree. So what is the purpose? And I would like to kind of limit our discussion to schools,
sure.
School sex education, and ask you, what is the purpose of sex education in school?
I think that the purpose of sex education is to prepare young people for a lifetime of sexual decision making. We shouldn't think of sex ed as happening only for the immediate future. But it prepares a young person for a lifetime of sexual decision-making. good decision making. It's similar to other subjects that we teach. We teach reading skills, we teach algebra, we teach geometry, not because it's an urgent need to solve something geometrical or algebraic puzzle right then and there on the spot, but because it teaches thinking skills that are useful as a person continues to grow older and needs to make decisions that are complex and to negotiate relationships and to engage in healthy relationships. So sex education is not necessarily for the moment, but for a person's future throughout their lives.
So what would, ideally, what should be included then?
You know, when people hear sex education, I think, you know, understandably, their minds first go to the act of sex or right. sexual intercourse and other sexual acts. But there's a whole lot more. People forget the duality of sexuality education. And so lessons should include discussions of body image and self-esteem. Lessons should include the basics, puberty and anatomy, but also healthy relationships and unhealthy relationships. What does consent mean? What is sexual coercion? How do you know when you're in a relationship that's exploitative? How do you get out of a relationship that's harmful? How do you make healthy decisions regarding behaviors that may adversely affect one's sexual decisions, such as drugs and alcohol? All of these are components of sexuality education that make for enriched discussions about learning and decision making that go well beyond the act of intercourse.
And certainly are very useful over the course, even over the course of K to 12 schooling. So at what age then would you start?
Well, you know, I think it's important that just to go off of school education for a moment. I think it's important that parents be aware that sexuality education is not isolated to a particular point in a young person's life. It's a continuous process. Young children are learning about sexuality from the attitudes that their parents display. The questions that they answer or they don't answer, their non-verbal responses, all of that signals attitudes that a young person begins learning well before they enter their first class. But when we think of K through 12 education, a lot of people hear the K and they think, oh my gosh, you know, are they going to distribute condoms in kindergarten?
Yeah, yeah.
And of course, that's not the case. When we're talking about kindergarten sex education, we may be talking about what makes up a family. We may be talking about, when we're talking about disease prevention, we're talking about the basics of germs and making sure that you cover your mouth when you sneeze, or nowadays the vampire. So all of that sets the foundation for basic understanding that is useful for further conversations when we're talking about condoms or when we're talking about pregnancy prevention, understanding the basics of how diseases develop or how a person becomes infected, all that is useful for these further conversations.
So it's developmental then?
Absolutely, yeah. Age-appropriate sex education, it's so important. I think that we need to let our experts guide us, and there are experts who have examined the appropriate ages mm-hmm. to talk about certain subjects and how to talk about those subjects. The national standards for sexuality education were just released a few months ago, and they serve as a wonderful guide for understanding what we should be teaching at different ages.
Who puts out the national standards if people want to take a look at them?
Yeah, the national standards was put out by a group called FOSSE, the Future of Sex Education, and it's
FOSSE.
FOSSE, mm-hmm. And it's a combination of a group called ANSWER and CECUS, the Sexuality Information mm-hmm. and Education Council of the U.S., and Advocates for Youth. And they had other partners and collaborators involved. It's really the next step from the old CECUS guidelines for mm-hmm. K through 12 education. And this is something that
that's
I think
good to know.
School districts should be looking at.
That it has just come out. If you were doing this, say, 30 years ago, would it look different from the way it would look today?
In some ways, I think it would. You know, thinking of 30 years ago brings me back into my own high school days and the early 80s and the lack of information that we had back then is similar to a lot of the lack of information that young people have today if they're not exposed to sexuality education or if they're receiving abstinence-only programs. Back in the early 80s, I remember that we had earliest discussions of HIV and AIDS, and my classmates and I had lots and lots of questions that we didn't know the answers to, and not a whole lot of teachers who knew how to direct us very well on the subject. So I think that there's this yearning for information that young people have that is
that
similar.
Hasn't changed?
That hasn't changed. The delivery of how we get information is quite different. I think that the internet is a major influence on how people learn about sexuality. There's access to erotica, pornography, that was very different for young people 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. Certainly not as accessible, certainly not as instantaneous. So there's a lot of information that is useful. There's websites that are...
Some of it is wrong.
Some of it is wrong. A lot of it is wrong. Yeah. But there's good stuff out there as well. There's also new discussions that we need to be talking about in sex ed. We need to be examining social media and social networking websites and the impact of websites like Facebook and how that affects bullying and... how we deal with sexting and teacher and school responses to these issues. And I think we need more than a draconian response that says, absolutely not, we're going to have you arrested and treated like a sex offender. There's got to be somewhere between that and useful education, discussions about consent, discussions about privacy and responsibility. I think those are all important things to be able to talk about in the classroom.
Exactly, yeah. Do states, I know the answer because I know that sex education has become very political, but what kinds of limits do states put on sex education? And are there the kinds of things that can be covered or cannot be covered? Are there certain grades in which they're willing to start it but not before?
Well, it is really a state-by-state handling of the subject. I think that there is no uniform thought, and that can be problematic because there's states like New Jersey that has a mandate for comprehensive family life education that's been in place since 1980, and that's wonderful. But there's also no mechanism for enforcement. So what happens in one school district may be wonderful in terms of sex ed, but it may not be happening in another district because there's no.
Is the mandate for comprehensive sex education from kindergarten, or are there certain grades?
It is age appropriate grade by grade. So they say by grade 3 you should be learning about X, Y, and Z. By grade 6 you should be learning about this and that. But again, the enforcement is what's different, and this is also true in many other states. The states that have what we might think of as the closest thing to sexuality education are actually mostly HIV prevention programs or teen pregnancy prevention programs. And these things are important, but these are not programs.
They're not comprehensive.
They're not comprehensive, and they're not always, they're talking about disaster prevention. They're not talking about everything that we need to know regarding.
Are there certain topics that tend not to be covered or that they're told that they shouldn't cover? For instance, gay and lesbian issues, other kinds of issues that the parents may not want their kids to be exposed to?
I think that probably the biggest problem is teachers self-censoring. So they may assume that they're not allowed to talk about sexual orientation. Mm-hmm. They may stay away from certain topics because they assume that that a parent is going to be upset or a school administrator is going to be upset, even though the research indicates that parents are overwhelmingly supportive of comprehensive sex education. But still, teachers do worry about the one teacher who's
going... They don't want to get in trouble.
They don't. And, you know, unfortunately, the parents that are supportive of sex ed are not always cheering it on, understandably. Many parents simply assume it's supposed to be happening.
Are parents still allowed to remove their child?
Absolutely.
For topics that they don't approve of?
Absolutely, yeah.
Are parents still given access to the curriculum so that they can take a look at it before it's presented to the kids?
Oh, absolutely. Any parent has that right to examine the content and of what their children are learning in any subject. The problem comes, I think, when a parent decides, not only do I not want my kid in this program, but I don't want any of the other kids in the program either. I want to shut down the program entirely, even though other parents may be supportive of it and are supportive of it.
Yeah, or sometimes they may approve of something, but only under certain conditions. You know, I'm thinking of, and this is not apropos of sex education, but I'm thinking of the bill before the Congress right now, which is the Violence Against Women Act, which has been passed twice by a bipartisan vote in the Congress, but now threatens not to be passed because we want to cover sexual orientation, we want to cover immigrants, we want to cover Native Americans, and somehow violence against them, I guess, is by some people is okay. Hmm. So the entire thing may go down because members of Congress don't want to cover certain people.
Yeah, and that's a shame because certainly discussions of violence against women or any domestic violence are important conversations that we need to be having with students.
I know. Yeah. Is sex education offered in single-sex classes or are they usually integrated?
There's not so much single-sex class anymore. There were years ago. Most of the best practice thinking on the subject says that when you mix boys and girls together, they can learn from each other. They can challenge each other's negative attitudes and assumptions, and they can listen to each other and keep the subject from being as mysterious and hidden and secretive as it used to be.
And they're getting the same content that way.
Absolutely.
We're getting certainty that it's the same content.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. If you have mixed gender groups, then everyone's learning the same thing.
Right.
Then there's no secrets. I think it's much better that way.
So they're more effective then.
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
Do poor communities want different emphases than more affluent communities?
I don't know if there's any differences in terms of the content of what's desired in poor communities. I think that the subjects are needed across the board. There may be fewer restrictions in some poor communities, and when I say that, I think of some of the programs that we provide in settings for kids who don't have the same means, who have less access to as much information as mm-hmm. as kids of means, and I think of halfway houses, and I think of juvenile detention centers where some of our resources are used, and very often in juvenile detention centers, the administrators are much, much more supportive of implementing sex ed. And it may be because they see that these kids are already sexually active and need the information more urgently, where I would argue that that the information is needed just as much in the schools, but there may not be this acceptance of
yes.
the amount of sexual activity that's going on.
Yeah, or they think they'll fight against it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now I want to ask you a question that is on everybody's minds because it relates to data that has just come out in a very influential report found that teen pregnancy all over the country for all racial and ethnic groups and every age group is down.
Yeah.
And I'd like to know what you and other experts believe that that's due to. I also would like to say that I had read recently that the greatest reduction is in the 15 to 17 year old.
Yeah.
And that the 18 and 19 has not changed. But so when we're talking about a serious reduction in teen pregnancy, we're really talking about the younger years.
Right. I think it's good news, but I think you know the full context is that while there have been substantial reductions in teen pregnancy, there's also the concern that our teen pregnancy rates have been so high to begin with. And I don't mean to rain on good news. It definitely is very, very good news. And as you said, it's happening across socioeconomic indicators. The problem has been that the United States has had the highest teen pregnancy rates in the developed world. And even with these reductions, we still have much higher rates than Western European countries, than just about every developed nation in the world, particularly those that are offering government-funded comprehensive sex education. The programs in other countries that address teen pregnancy prevention, STD and sexually transmitted infection prevention, have integrated approaches that involve media campaigns and school education and access to clinics and health services. In the United States, we've not had all of that, and I think overall our rates have been much higher.
But why have they been going down?
Researchers are saying that part of it is what they call regressing to back to the mean. That we our numbers were so high to begin with that they naturally do decline. But some experts, I was speaking with just today with a colleague at Advocates for Youth, who was saying that that about 75% of the reduction is related to overall increased contraceptive use, and about a quarter of the reduction is related to delays in onset of sexual activity.
Initiation,
mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's a combination of factors at play.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting also when you talked about the fact that we have a much higher incidence, because one of the byproducts of that is much higher maternal mortality, where we're losing teenagers because at a certain age they're really at risk when they bear a child.
Yeah.
And infant mortality is higher among them. So those are two areas that can be reduced substantially by reducing teen pregnancy. And I think that's a great benefit of sex education as well.
Yeah, and I think these are outcomes that all of society wants. I mean, we don't want young people, teenagers, to be becoming pregnant, to have giving birth before they're ready. So I think that this is something that we as a society want and should want to address.
Yeah, and while we're talking about that, young teens, I want to ask you about, some people call it date rape, but I'm just referring to not necessarily rape, but brutality or violence in dating relationships, and ask you, what do you think is the pressures on kids to behave in ways that they're not comfortable with and probably they wish they were not engaging in, but they're still doing it?
Yeah. Well, I think that what we need to do as far as sex education is concerned is to teach healthy behaviors in the classroom and to teach what a healthy relationship looks like. One of our teaching manuals unequal partners, teaching about power and consent in relationships, examines not just the overt sexual violence or physical violence between couples, but also the less obvious aspects of problems in a relationship. For example, if your partner is texting you all the time and trying to keep tabs on where you are, we want young people to be able to understand that that is a sign of a controlling or coercive relationship. If your partner is putting you down in public, now that's not physical violence, but that's definitely the sign of an unhealthy relationship. Mm-hmm. So our teaching manual on equal partners tries to teach young people about how to identify healthy and unhealthy signs in a relationship, how to negotiate health in a relationship, how to get out of a relationship when there's unhealthy things going on.
And that book, Unequal Partners, is also available at the same site
that you gave us,
www.sexedstore.com.
That's right, yeah.
Thank you. That's very useful. I wanted to ask you also about a new law that was just passed in Wisconsin that says that sex education must promote marriage, which is interesting in the light of the issue of marriage equality, must instruct students that abstinence is the only reliable way to avoid pregnancy and STDs. And while it allows schools to offer abstinence only, which is a shift from the previous law. And that's interesting because we thought we were going in the other direction toward more abstinence plus. But in this case, they are allowing abstinence only. And what do you think would be the effect of that change?
Well, I think the effect will be similar to some of the effect that we've seen overall in terms of the quality of education as it relates to abstinence-only until marriage programs. And we've seen a few decades now of abstinence-only until marriage funded programs, and it sounds like what's happening in Wisconsin is moving more toward the old federal guidelines on what's allowed to be taught. I don't think that these things that are being taught and required are helpful. I think for one thing, they discount lesbian and gay kids. When you're telling lesbian and gay kids that you can't have sex until you're married, but haha, gotcha, can't get married either.
Right.
That's...
And their parents, too, because some of them have gay parents. This time has gone so fast, and this has been fascinating. You've really updated us on something that hopefully continues to change more in the right direction than in the wrong direction. And I appreciate it.
Well, thanks so much for having me.